Hi everybody, it's Sandy, and I'm bringing you a video today, the day before Thanksgiving. I'm calling it hyperrealism, but please don't be confused. This is not a class in hyperrealism by any means. This was a card that I made a while ago, and I got so many comments on my blog and on Instagram and all kinds of other places that I figured I would give it a technique refresh. The layout is a little bit different. The acorns and leaves are in different places. The original card, I didn't actually intend on using that whole panel on a card. I had just stamped some of the images because I wanted to color them. I had just gotten the stamp set from Ellen Hutson, and I ended up thinking, well, they did look kind of unified on that panel because I had the light coming all from the same place. I was going to cut it off and put it on some patterned paper, and then I thought, well, let me try coloring some patterned paper. So that card was all one layer. And yes, you can go click backwards and go see it again, because yes, it was one layer. So I am attempting to recreate it, but in a slightly different way, because I never seem to use the same colors twice on anything, so there you go. The acorns on this were the hardest part, so I did them first. And the reason that they're the hardest part is that they're little round objects, but they're each facing a different direction, which means the light is going to hit each one in a different spot. And that means you really have to study where light falls on objects. I went to college for this. I studied illustration and did many years of still life studies and that kind of thing. If you really want to learn this, YouTube is not the place to get that kind of really in-depth education. You can pick up some tips from a video like this, but please know that this is not intended to teach you how to do this. It's just going to walk you through a few things. I have so much else going on in my head when I'm doing this kind of coloring that there's no way I could ever deliver to you in a little package what I've done on this and how I arrived at the decisions to put what colors where or what shadows where. So hopefully you'll still enjoy it anyway. And it is Thanksgiving and it's a thank you card, so I figured that would all at least be thematically suitable for the day. I'm pulling this YR23 across all of the leaves. The little roundy leaves are going to be greens, and the other ones are going to be orange and gold types of leaves, but I wanted at least one color to cross between the two so that this whole thing would be kind of unified. A lot of times I see people try to use every color in the rainbow and make every object completely different, and at least having some small color in common unifies an image and just, I don't know, it makes it come together for me a whole lot more. So I'm adding the orange colors to my leaves, and you can see by the 8 on the end, I'm looking for some kind of desaturated, darkish colors. I don't want things that are super bright, except my YA17, because I gotta have that on. Anything that has yellow in it, because that's my favorite color. But I'm dulling everything down with colors as much as possible, because I don't want it to be screamy bright. And even some of these colors are a little bright that I'm putting underneath, and then I'm going to add a lot of texture on top of them. And I'm going in right now with this E19. Because I wanted to add some darker shadows. And as I'm doing that, I'm also in the medium areas that aren't the dark shadows, I'm just adding some lines so I can add the veins of the leaves. I have no idea if this is the right direction for any of the veins to go, but that's the way that my hand started making the lines, so that's the way it went. If you really want to look at what the leaves actually should look like and what those veins should look like, then go to Google and start looking for leaves that are like the colors of, or the shapes of the leaves that you're coloring on something. I pull up images all the time to find out what they really look like if I'm trying to mimic that reality. So I'm using an E15, which is a little lighter than the E18, and adding more lines as I go into those lighter areas in lighter colors, so that the darker colors, the darker lines are only in some of the parts. If you put the darker lines across everything, it just turns into one blob. And we don't want that. No blobs in the coloring. So next I'm doing the green leaves, and I'm using my favorite YG9s. I really, really like these for any kind of natural looking leaves. The color itself is really dull, but it has that YG vibrance as well. And it just makes for a really nice, normal looking leaf. If you use the G0s, which a lot of people like to use, those are just so bright. And I don't usually use those unless I'm trying to do some like really super fluffy sweet flowers or sweet leaves and grasses instead of the realistic kind. So realism, I tend to stay with desaturated darker colors a lot more because that's what I see in real life around me. I'm blending out a little bit more with the YR23 just to make sure I get enough of that color in there. And then I'm going to jet on to the berries. I'm using an R05, which is a really red. It doesn't have any of that purplishness in it. And to make the shadows on them, I'm actually using an E09 instead of a dark red. I usually like my R89, but for something like this, I really wanted to make sure I got some really brownish kind of color. And adding my little highlights with my Signo pen. Next, I'm going to start working on the shadows. And this is where people get scared. The W5 is a very dark color. I'll warn you that right now. And a lot of people would never be able to start out with this because it'll just turn into mud on your paper. So if you want to try something like this, I would start with lighter colors until you get the hang of it. I'm going to add my shadows. The light's coming from the upper right, so the shadows go to the lower left. And I'm trying to mimic some of the shapes of some of these leaves. And when the shadow, when the leaf curls up and it's lifted higher, you get more shadow. If it's exactly on the surface of the paper or of the ground or the table or whatever it's on, you'll get less shadow. So I like to vary them so that some areas have less shadow and some have more, and that gives them that feeling that they're curved, because that's what leaves do in real life. Some of the points touch the ground and some of them are kind of up in the air a little bit. And so I just try to create some of that dimension that way. Under the berries, I'm only putting a little dot of the darkest color right under the berries themselves. I'm going to put a final touch on it later when I do the shadow for the stems of the berries. But for right now, I just want to leave that really soft. So I'm taking my W2 and softening out those W5 shadows, stretching them a little bit further and just softening them, because shadows sometimes are really hard and sometimes they're not, and it all depends on how strong the light is, how close the object is to the ground. There's a whole bajillion ways to look at shadows, and if you study them in real life, it'll help you to see a whole lot more about how you can make your shadows look more realistic. Soften all these out. Next, I'm going to soften them out even further with the woo marker. For some reason, I see woo instead of W00 when I look at that. But yeah, woo, let's do shadows. So I'm just softening these and letting the color kind of just, I'm even in some of the places where the shadow got too dark, if I go over it with the W00, it kind of removes a little of that color. And then I'll add some other dark shadows back in. Just keep working back and forth on this until I get it the way I want it. I got some modeling, you know, M-O-T-T-L-I-N-G, in some of the shadows. So I'm going over them quickly, just a couple strokes of the W3. It's just going to smooth out a little bit of that and make them a little bit more consistent. And then I'm going to dive back in with dark shadows again. And I went in, this time is a W7. Remember that I started with the W3, the W5. So I'm going even darker, and I'm just taking the very, very, very darkest spots and adding a little bit of that W7 to them. This is dangerous because you can easily get too much. And as soon as you get too much, everything's going to look like it's just got a big old black soot on the bottom, and you don't want to get to the point where you have this. So I've softened those shadows a little bit further, and I'm going in with a W2 and drawing in my shadows now for each one of those little teeny tiny stems on the little berries. If you're really fascinated, then go back in and watch that section in high def and on a big screen on your computer, because it's hard to explain what I was doing there. Easier to see where those shadows fall by just looking at it. Now here I had a big blooper, and you'll see that in just a few minutes, but my YR18 marker was starting to run out, so I went off and filled it, and look what happened when I came back. Bloop! Major bloop. I was very disappointed in that. So I finished at least coloring one layer of the YR18 on that panel, and then I went in with my Copic Opaque White and started covering it. And what I found is the opaque white covers pretty much everything, but when you have this much saturation, it'll need another coat of that. So I'll put another coat of that on later. So just for the sake of being careful, I decided to put some post-it tape onto that half of the image so that I don't make a mess on it. Now, you can't just completely cover over this post-it tape or even any post-it note, because Copic Marker will eventually, if you do a bunch of coats of it, it will sink through. Just like ink, if you stamp it over and over and over again in the same area, that ink will go through it because it's just paper. So I'm not going to go over it, but it's just going to keep me from making any stray marks as I do this kind of wild coloring. So I'm adding just a bunch of different colors to this panel and softening them out as I go and just letting the color blend. I wanted it to look, I don't know, if it's woodish, if it's paintish, I'm not really sure what it is, but I just mixed a bunch of colors. But putting that E29 right along that edge really enhances that shadow. And now I want to add something a little bit more to it, so I'm spritzing it with some colorless blender, and that's going to lighten it up and also add some texture. And I'm going to add a little bit more texture using some of the markers that I've been using already in this entire image, so that it'll, you know, just add a little bit more to it as I get finished. I'm going to add a little bit of the opaque white to add just a few dots to that and make it a little bit more interesting and have a little bit more light color over there on that left hand side. And with that final added detail, the card is finished. And it is one layer. You saw it all happen right here on the YouTubes. I did use Neenah Solar White 110-pound cardstock, which is great for one layer cards. And Neenah is almost exclusively what I use for my Copic coloring. So here are a few more videos if you'd like to check out some of my other work that was published recently. And otherwise, get back to your Thanksgiving with your family. I hope you have a really great holiday. Leave me a comment in the doobly-doo and tell me what you are most thankful for this year. And I'll talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.